up in my feelings. Spend so much time trying to play it safe, but the safety is just an illusion when I'm called to be fearless. So here I come, I wanna follow where you're leading me. Time to let go, it's sink or swim now. So I
got me singing joy like a fire burning light. Welcome to Her Story. It's so good to be with you, and it's really great to be with my friend Hanna Golding, previously
Hanna Thomas Swain.
Yes. She got married here in the church, and it was a great day. Well, it was actually outside, but it was within our family. Mm-hmm. So I'm really happy to be able to bring this story because it's been a long time coming. Mm-hmm. So how long have you actually been at the Rock Church?
I've been coming since I was about 12 years old.
Wow. And how old are you now?
I am 24.
12 years. Mm-hmm. It's been a long time. And I have wanted to have Hanna share her story for many, many years. And because God has done so many good things in her life, mm-hmm. and she has desired to run after him as he runs after you. Mm-hmm. So you're going to enjoy this story, and I'm glad you're here with us. So tell us a little bit about Hanna, where it all started.
Well, it started when I guess I was born.
Yeah, that's a great place to start.
So my parents, I wasn't expected necessarily by them. They were living together in Nova Scotia, and it wasn't a totally civil place between them. Mm-hmm. They had a lot going on between them, and lots of conflict and lots of difficult things for a baby to be born into. Yeah. So that's sort of where I began. And from there, my mom moved with me to Unity with my grandparents, and I got to live with my grandparents there for a while, which was a blessing because mm-hmm. I got to be on the farm with them and with extra parents. I needed that.
Yeah, so what kind of a little girl were you, Hanna?
I was very energetic, very personable, but also mostly liked my mom. Yeah. Very joyful since I was little. Mm-hmm. And excitable.
Yes, and I know Hanna's mom, and she is lovely, and they are very similar in their, just the way their mannerisms are the same, and so, well, you look the same as well. But yes, you are still that way. That's still the Hanna that we know. Very, very joy-filled and just bubbly. Hmm. You're a bubbly person. Fun to be around. Hmm. Yeah. And then some things tried to steal that bubbliness out of you, I think, mm-hmm. from what I have seen and what I have heard. Tell us a little bit about that.
Since I was born, I can see how the fear tried to grab a hold of me, and just the spiritual side of the fear that really can try to attach itself onto you. Mm. And so from a young age, I experienced a lot of fear and a lot of anxiety and a lot of just difficulty overcoming in my day-to-day life as a kid.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Do you think you would have known that at that point?
When I was young, I knew that there was a difference because I could tell kids at school didn't have that. And I remember I couldn't even go to school a lot of the time. I couldn't do regular activities and be consistent in things through my childhood. And I was like crying at school all the time. I would make up stories so that I could be sent home and things like that. So yeah. I did know from a young age that there was a difference in me from other kids in the aspect of fear. So, yeah.
That's really interesting. Makes me think a lot about our kids at Bible, though. And
for sure.
Shift and C23. So kind of paint us a picture how that fear attached itself. Some of the main things that happened in your life.
Yeah. So when I was, since I was about one, I started going to, my parents split up when I moved to Unity with my mom. And so from there, my mom met my stepdad and my dad met my stepmom. And so since I was about 1 year old, I started seeing my stepmom. And at that time, I can see how that really brought a lot of fear into my life and was emotionally destructive to me and a lot of control and just shaped my life in the direction of fear. I was going back and forth between my mom's and my dad's every second weekend and then half time in the summer. And I can see how through that I had a lot of fearful memories and a lot of times that I was not regulated, was not emotionally able to overcome. And luckily my mom helped me in that a lot. I have lots of memories of her sitting with me and helping me through those difficult moments.
Yeah, she's a really good mom. Really helped even out those ups and those downs. Tell us about how, like, because you said you had to prepare yourself, like, to go back and forth.
Yeah.
What's that like for a child to have to prepare their mind to do that?
Well, you don't know a lot about how to do that as a kid.
Yeah.
As an adult, it's hard, right?
Yes.
So as a kid, I found that I was very, I just would shut down. I was in fight and flight a lot of the time.
Yeah.
Like I said, I wasn't going to school, like leading up to the days that I had to leave my house. And so I have memories of wrapping myself around table legs and sitting on the couch with my mom for many hours, just trying to prepare myself for like to walk through fear and, to learn how to face fear and to put myself consistently in that position for many years, for about 14 years.
It's a long time.
Yeah, it's a long time to chronically deal with fear and to be put in a position where you know that you're going to be afraid over and over again. And so, I cried so much as a kid. I just needed so much help to be secure and to be regulated.
Yeah, yeah. And I know from your story, some of the deregulating things were that when you got to your mom and dad's, your dad actually worked away a lot, right? So he was often not even there.
Yes. Yeah. So I would just stay with my stepmom when I would go over there a lot of the time.
Yeah.
And so.
And then all of the things that were surrounding you as the child to try to make it okay for
everybody. Yeah.
And that is your personality too, to try and bring okayness and peace into a place. So what did you do to bring that okayness and peace to try and just feel seem like everything's good?
Yeah. So like I remember even in grade one, like after kindergarten, I still was pretty off the walls doing what I needed to do to show my emotions and to make it through. But by the time I was about six, I was already really good at hiding my emotions and just appearing okay. And even though I'm sure people knew I wasn't okay, if you looked at me, but I was really also really good at hiding and just putting a mask on myself to be okay in whatever situation I had to be. And so, I remember just like, I would just ask my mom, does it look like I was crying? And okay, I'm gonna be okay now, and just decide that I was going to move forward to be okay. Even though inside you're not okay.
It just makes me so sad for you and for so many kids that are trying to keep everything
pushed down under control. It's hard to keep things under control as a kid.
It really is.
But kids do a very good job of it, surprisingly.
Amazing.
Yeah.
For all the things, chaos going on. Mm-hmm. And thank you for saying it, because that is part of what we want to always remind ourselves about around here, that we can't expect kids to come in and we don't know what they've been dealing with all week and all day after school, you know, with bullying or trying to get through the day at school with the insecurity.
So much emotion.
And then we think, well, you should just listen to what I say.
Sit down.
Yeah. So, Hanna, you've had a really, really great perspective because of that. Because of your experience, I've heard you say many, many times, I was a Bible-Bill kid. I can relate to these guys, and I know what it feels like to just have all this pent-up emotion, and what do I do with it, and where do I go with it, and where is a safe place to process it.
Yes, and lots of kids don't have a safe place to process it, and I did a lot of the time, which very much helped me as a kid.
Yes.
But it can look so different. Like, for every kid, they kind of can respond differently. And for me, I just covered it up and acted okay. Mm-hmm. But a lot of the time, it can look like just acting out badly, or being so defiant, or being angry, or just different ways. So for me, I just kept everything under control and showed everybody that, I'm okay. And everybody will be okay if I'm okay.
Yeah. And that is how I saw you when I met you, that you were.
I bet.
And I even knew some of the backstory from your mom then. So I knew how much chaos you were having to hold and deal with. But you really have a way of just making other people okay, even when you're not feeling okay. So closely after you came to the Rock, something really devastating happened in your life, and it still affects you today, literally today.
Yes, today.
She's dealing with some pain, people, and so it's, her sitting here is a miracle, and very thankful for that. But tell us what happened.
So I was a cheerleader. And that was a really big saving grace for me. It kept me occupied with something. It allowed me to put my passion towards something and to focus on something other than the things I was experiencing. It just really let me pour myself into something. And so, but through that, unfortunately, I broke my neck. I tore the ligaments between my vertebrae. And so I had a neck brace for about 5 months, and I had neck surgery in there.
And you were?
And I was 13.
Yeah. She was 13 years old. Just a little one.
Yeah.
It was a lot to go to school with that.
Yes, but I was determined to go.
Yes, you were.
I went to grade 9 even against the doctor's orders, because I didn't want to miss out.
You just dragged yourself out,
Yeah.
So FOMO has always been
a part of my life. Yeah.
Fear of missing out.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted you to, so that was, how did that change your world, first of all?
Well, that really brought a lot of surrender to my life because cheerleading was my thing and I was not willing to give that up at any cost. And so even when I broke my neck, I didn't care about anything except when can I go back? And that was my priority. But I really see how God used that as a way to make me surrender in a sense that like he really used that to transform my heart so that I was able to say, you know, even if I can't cheerlead, maybe there's more to life, right? Mm. And so I needed that step, I think, in order to be able to start surrendering things to God, because that was really the starting point, I think, of surrender for me.
Mm. And God had a place in your life at an early age, right? Tell us a little bit about that, those little moments where you know he was planting seeds and then the surrender. It was a process,
yes,
right?
Yes, it was a long process.
Yeah.
Still is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But when I was about 11 or 12, around, like just before I had broken my neck, I started to ask more questions to my mom, and I started to want to have a way out of my current situation with my family, and going back and forth, and some of the dysfunction that happened. And so I started asking questions, and I remember saying to my mom, "I'm going to help kids like me one day." And so it's just so cool to think about.
It is. Yeah, you planted it in your heart.
Yeah.
Very early on.
Yeah.
What was a verse that really stuck with you through those years?
Perfect love casts out fear. Mm-hmm. And that verse, I don't know how old I would have been, but my mom had written it out and put it at the head of my bed on the wall. And yeah, sorry. Emotional to talk about.
Mm-hmm. It's so precious to know how he did, how he spoke those words.
He rescued
over
me.
You.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Literally over your head.
Yes. And so these words were over my head, like a banner. And God, even when I didn't know what it meant, and I would just read this and say, okay, perfect love casts out fear, but I still have fear. And I don't know what that means for me, because I still have fear and this love thing isn't working.
Right.
And so I can see how...
Alicia, we might need a Kleenex.
Yeah, that would be great. Thank you.
Thank you. She's more than just tech support.
Yeah, she's emotional support too.
That's right.
Just that God prays things over us, and Jesus was speaking that over me for so many years. And now I can see what it means a lot more.
Yeah.
And I have experienced his perfect love, and it's different than human love. It's different than any other type of love.
Yeah.
And it is the kind of love that casts out fear, and I can see how he's done that for me through all of those years, even when I didn't see it happening yet. Now looking back, I can see how I was delivered from the spirit of fear in so many ways.
Yeah, in different areas of your life.
Yeah.
And at that point, in those teenage years, he really started to draw you. So as you surrendered your life after having the accident with your neck, then how, and he was delivering you from fear, and he was calling you to surrender, like in so many ways from what I remember.
Yep.
What opportunities did he start to give you to just plant those seeds of love? And not just you had love from God to you, but you started to flow with love. Tell us about that.
So like through that time, I was able to come to a kind of a crossroads of, I had to choose a missions trip for cheerleading in the short version.
Yeah.
And so God had given me this option. And I did something I thought I could never do, and that was to choose not cheerleading.
Yeah.
And so that was kind of, that was a big surrender moment again. So the first time it was kind of forced. The second time I had chosen to give it up.
Yeah.
And I chose God instead. And so it felt like a very pivotal thing for me. Mm-hmm. And so I went to Jamaica on a missions trip. And through all of those years at the Rock, I was healing and had different encounters with God. And I remember moments of worship and just being like, I don't know why I'm crying. I've never had this before.
Yes.
But when I went to Jamaica, that's when I remember the first time that the Bible like made sense to me. Mm. Like I remember reading something and I'm like, oh, like I found a crayon in the kids' room and I was like coloring things with crayon because that's all I had. And I'm like, this makes sense. And that was when I really realized in Jamaica, I was like, this is not all that I thought it was, and this I'm surrendering my whole life. And so that's when I was like, I'm all in. And I surrendered my whole life and all of my things to God, and he flowed through me in Jamaica. And I think that, and through Jamaica, that's when I had heard God speak so clearly to me for the first time, it felt like, of to do a YWAM, and I didn't even know what a YWAM was that time when he spoke it. So from there I did a YWAM, and then from there I started working here at the Rock Church. So it's just been a unfolding.
Totally.
Yep.
Yes, he had so much more for you. During that time, also some family stuff happened that was tough. Maybe you want to talk about just, you've had considerable moments where you have had to choose to allow that perfect love to cast out all fear.
Yeah.
What was that one?
When I was about 16, my mom made the decision to leave our family, and that was best for her. And so that was really challenging for me.
Yeah.
And because she was really my person through all of the difficulty I had gone through.
Absolutely.
So that really caused me, well, first to just kind of go off and do my own thing and be independent and look to friends and to the world and things like that to try to fill the voids in my heart. And then through that, that's when I made the decision to go on the missions trip and surrender after that. So that was sort of in the middle there.
Right.
But it was another stepping stone to just me and Jesus and full dependence on him.
Mm-hmm. It amazes me how Jesus prepares us as well as calls us to be dependent on only him in so many ways that are frightening to think of.
Yeah.
Because losses, it's just, those are big losses, right?
Yeah.
Where you think that you can be secure in your home, secure in your cheerleading, secure in your mom, secure in, there's all these things, and God goes,
you can't be secure in anything but me.
So I know that through that God has launched you quicker into surrender than a lot of people have to nail that thing down. And because of it, he gave you a special anointing to do some really cool things here at the Rock. So I remember the day that we sat down with Hanna and we asked her if she would be our Bibleville director. And it was such a Holy Spirit presence in that room that I remember, to know that she was had so much confirmation.
Hmm.
So
yeah,
tell us about Bible though.
Mm-hmm.
And the joy that the ups, the downs, the highs, the lows,
yes,
of Bibleville and camps and all those,
yeah,
things.
Well, it sort of, like, it's funny because it surprised me to be asked to lead Bibleville. Like, I didn't expect that, but then again, I also had these things that God was speaking to me and showing, mm-hmm, me, and so to see, oh, that's what you had, God. You want me to lead Bibleville? Okay.
Yes.
And it started as just camp. And then I had ended up being the leader for the next 3.5 years after that as well. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, Bibleville set me free in a lot of ways, mm, and allowed me to use my calling and my gift that God had given me with kids, and to see kids who I could relate to in their childhood experiences, like not everything, of course, but seeing them in their emotional state and in their spiritual state, I could relate to that. And so,
yeah,
Bibleville is fun. Bibleville is wild. And you just really get to see God work in so many different ways. Mm-hmm. And so it's very special. Mm-hmm. And I've gotten to sit and regulate so many kids who needed that.
Yes.
And pray with so many kids, and be able to have a connection and an empathy for them that I wouldn't have otherwise had, I don't think.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, I really got to be set free in my own fear in a further way,
yeah,
through the healing that I received through Bibleville and all of the ministry that my heart needed, that
so
I
cool
received through it. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's so cool how, mm-hmm, God does that through. When we get to feel the love pouring out,
mm-hmm,
of us and see what it does to another human being, it's really powerful.
Life-changing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And in the last couple years, there was one really great thing that came into your life. Tell us about him. We're big fans.
I got married in COVID.
Yes.
In June 2020, which was, yeah, another thing. Like, you just don't know how your life is going to unfold. And so,
yes,
the timing of meeting Daniel and getting married was just, yeah, God's timing.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, I get to go on a new adventure of marriage and learning how to be a wife and what God is calling me to in that, and how God is, yeah, using me in lots of different ways through that. So,
yeah, he is. And they are a great couple who lead our young adults group, and we just love them, couldn't love them anymore. We are so proud of them. So, and the latest announcement that I will tie things up with before we pray is that Hanna is one of our summer students this,
mm-hmm,
year. So she's come back again, which this feels like we won the lottery of summer students. Three summer students this year that we had, mm-hmm, funding for from the federal government, and we're really thankful for it. And Hanna is one of,
mm-hmm,
them. Even though she's already been on staff, she's come back as a, mm-hmm, student. And so that's a really easy student to lead.
It's a gift to me.
When she already knows how to do so many things. She leads us, as Alicia says, yeah. So she will be leading lots of camp things this,
mm-hmm,
summer. We love camp.
Camp's
love
my
to
favorite
do it
part.
Mm-hmm.
Favorite part of the job.
So much happens at camp.
Yeah.
And God just shows up in a special way.
Mm-hmm.
So we, on that note, on that camp note, we invite you to check things out if you are interested in joining us. The last 3 weeks of July, Bibleville camp with the little guys. Then the middle years is shift camp. And then the final week of July is C23 youth, mm-hmm, camp. They're all 5-day camps, Monday to Friday. and we still need a lifeguard for the camps. We still need some cooks. We still need some pre-camp help, and we need some male leaders. Mm-hmm.
Male cabin leaders.
For shift and
Bible fill and C23.
All three. We need male leaders.
I think all of them.
Period.
Yeah.
So those are the main highlights, mm-hmm. I think, for that.
Yep.
But we're excited for what God's going to do, mm-hmm. there. And so call, email, text, mm-hmm. whatever you would like, and we would love to hear from you. I would just love for you to pray, Hanna, for anybody who has experienced fear, mm-hmm. and that really needs to know the regulation of Holy Spirit, mm-hmm. if I can use that, mm-hmm. terminology, just giving safe space to flow that perfect love.
Yes.
So pray, mm-hmm. for us.
God, we just thank you so much that you do set us free, and that you want to use everything in our life to set us free. Mm-hmm. And so you do take what the enemy means for evil, and you turn it for your glory and for your good and, yes. for our good. And so I pray for anybody who is experiencing fear, and I pray that you would first bring the hope and the just the vision of freedom, and that there is a way out. And yeah, Lord, I just pray that you would bring your presence, your regulating presence, that you created our emotions, you created our minds and our bodies and our souls and our will. You created every part of us, and so that you would, in that intimate place, just give us everything that we need to be made whole, mm-hmm. and that the fear would not be overcoming, but that we would be able to surrender in the midst of fear and just give it all to you, God. And so I pray for your freedom to come into every person who is listening today. In Jesus' name, mm-hmm. amen.
Amen. Thank you, Hanna. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thanks for being with us. And next month, for the month of July, first Tuesday, we will be doing kind of a fun little thing where I'm going to share the journey of HERstory. And I'm going to share my particular journey of HERstory. Mm. And so it's been 19 years.
Wow.
In October. And the last 2 years, of course, have been online, so that was very different. But it's been a real journey, mm-hmm. and we're just going to highlight some of the things that God has done and things that God's been speaking to me about. So please join us for that, mm-hmm. and may you have a wonderful, wonderful month of June. God bless you. Yeah.
was there.